Hi, I'm Kalpana, working as a guest degree lecturer in TTWRDC Women's Kottagudam. Now we will discuss about the cell. Then what is the cell? Cell is the actual basic and fundamental unit of life. What is a unit? For example, you will take a height. A minimum measure to the height is the centimeter. As well, you will take liters. And a minimum unit for liters is the ml. Likewise, this for life, cell is considered as a minimum basic unit, as it is a starting point, though it's presence also in the prokaryotes along with the eukaryotes. The only difference between the prokaryotes and eukaryotes is prokaryotes doesn't contain a nuclear membrane in itself, and eukaryotes contains a nuclear membrane. Then within the eukaryotes there are different types of organ. We'll take plants and animals as a specific example. Then the difference between the plant and animal cell is, especially the plants containing cell wall, the animals is the main feature concerns with the plant cell. So, we'll specifically discuss about the ultrastructure of the plant cell in discussing different parts of the portions which are present in the cell. Now, we'll discuss about the different parts of the plant cell. First one is cell wall. Second one is plasma membrane. Third one is cytoplasm. Fourth one is cell organelles. Fifth one is nucleus. All these very basic portions inside the cell performs definite functions to run its normal functions and to continue life. Okay? Then we'll discuss in depth into a cell wall specifically. As I already said that cell wall is the special feature of the plant cell conforms rigidity, and which feature giving rigidity and mechanical strength to the cell wall. To discuss about that, we need to know about the structural composition of the cell wall. Actually, a plant cell wall is composed of polysaccharide units. These polysaccharide units are nothing, components of the glucose. Those are cellulose, hemicellulose, pectin, suberin, lignin, etc. are the structural components of polysaccharides with which a plant cell wall is made up of. Because of the presence of this substance only conforms rigidity and mechanical strength to the plant cell. Let's know the parts of the cell wall specifically. Is divided into three main portions known as primary cell wall, middle lamellum, and secondary cell wall. Okay, then how all those three layers are arranged? First of all, we need to know about middle lamellum, that is the name itself indicating its origin at the center or middle portion. So, middle lamellum is the structure which is present at the center, and it is meant to connect two cells. Middle lamellum is the portion which is useful to connect two cells. It is an intermediate portion meant to connect the two individual cells. So middle lamella is a structure which is present at the center part of the cell wall. And to the middle lamellum, when comes to, if you want to know the structural composition of the middle lamellum, as it is composed of microfibrils, then what are microfibrils? Microfibrils are nothing, those are also polysaccharide components, but specifically those are possessing a membranous or a fibrous structure. So uniquely that gives a cement like functionality in connecting the two cells. Okay, no confusion. Middle lamella is the main portion of the cell wall which is involved in the connection of two cells, as it is composed of microfibrils. Those are also polysaccharide units, but only the difference is they are fibrous like or a thread like in giving strength or mechanical rigidity, as well it also involved in the connection of two cells by lying at the central portion. Okay, then after the middle lamellum, there one more layer which is surround both the sides of the middle lamella is known as primary cell wall. We know this as the primary cell wall. So this side of the cell is the primary cell wall of this cell, and you consider it as A and it as the B cell. Then this the layer relates to the cell A, and this is the layer relates to the cell B. Okay, then on to the primary cell wall, there's one more layer which is known as secondary cell wall. As a primary cell wall is a single layer which is present both sides of the middle lamella. When comes to the secondary cell wall, okay, secondary cell wall is also present on to the secondary cell wall and also from the both the sides of the cell. But only the difference between the primary cell wall and the secondary cell wall is, the secondary cell wall is specifically composed of three layers. Secondary cell wall is composed of three layers known as S1, S2, S3. So with the three layers, uniquely the structure of secondary cell wall has formed. Secondary cell wall consists of three layers known as S1, S1, and S2, 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 and S3. Okay, and this known as, this is the portion known as secondary cell wall with three layers of S1, S2, and S3. And this black portion is known as primary cell wall, and this red portion is known as middle lamellum. So with unitedly all these three parts, a structure of cell wall has composed. It unitedly meant for giving rigidity and mechanical strength. One more, I'm repeating, middle lamella is a central portion, acts like a cement layer by connecting the two cells. So onto the middle lamellum, there's a single layer of primary cell wall, and onto the primary cell wall, there are three layers of secondary cell wall. And you can identify a space at the portion of the secondary cell wall. It is known as pit. A space obtained at the portion of secondary cell wall is known as pit, and it is meant, as you come to know that a secondary cell wall is also a thick structure by having a three layers, no? Uniquely it is composed of three layers. And to facilitate a movement from this cell to this cell, it is an opportunity. It's a facility provided by means of a space known as pit or pit chamber. So it is composed of a layer known as a pit membrane. So all together it is known as the structure of the cell wall. Okay, as it is the structure of the cell wall, you can identify very clearly a space at the portion of the secondary cell wall, no? Then the space is specifically known as pit, which is meant to translocation from one cell to the another cell. Okay, based on the formation of our pits, these pits are divided into two types. Let's know the types of the pits. First one is simple pit. When we call a simple pit, for example, if a secondary layer present in this map, you can observe very clearly a space which is occupied at the junction of a pit. Now, here you can observe the width and the length is so equal. If a pit or a pit chamber having an equal length and equal diameter, then we'll consider it as a simple pit. Then you also mind the difference of a border pit to the simple pit after drawing this border. Let's go to border pit. What are border pits? Border pits are also a same like that structure, but only the difference is they have bent like an arc. These border pits have bent like an arc. Like this. So, if the structure of the secondary cell wall in this manner, we'll consider this as a border pit. Then what's the difference between this simple pit and the border pit? You can observe very clearly here, the length and the diameter is so equal, but when it comes to here, it is so narrowed at the base. The diameter is so narrowed while coming to the base. If a pit containing a narrow base and the secondary wall, if it bends like an arc at that condition, we'll consider it as the border pit. All these notes and information, we came to know that the structural composition of the cell wall. If we'll go into the function of the cell wall, as I already told, it is meant to give rigidity and mechanical strength from starting point of time. Then you need to know one more point, that is by having a pit and pit chambers like structures, this cell wall is also facilitate transportation from one cell to another cell. So uniquely this is the feature of the cell. Okay, by completing it we need to enter into cytoplasm. About the cell wall, then you need to see the feature of the cell wall, how it is present in a plant cell. So this feature of the cell wall is specifically like this, by having three unique layers. One thing that I have forgot to say is the presence of a plasmodesmata. Plasmodesmata are nothing, connections which are present at the cell wall portion for the purpose of facilitation of or translocation of mineral nutrients from one cell to another cell. So this is the structure of the cell wall if you observe ultra structurally. So we have completed already the this question, then we need to jump into the second part of the plant cell, that is known as the plasma membrane. We need to the second portion known as plasma membrane. The name itself indicating, no, it is a membrane structure. Okay, inside the, just beneath the cell wall or inside to the cell wall, there is a presence of a membranous layer surrounding the inside portion of the cell wall known as a plasma membrane. The name itself indicating it is a membranous layer, a layer like structure which is present inside the cell wall known as plasma membrane. Then come to know the structure and functional features of the plasma membrane. This plasma membrane is composed of proteins and phospholipids. Components of the plasma membrane are proteins and phospholipids. Okay, this membranous layer is uniquely composed of these two things, no? Based on the composition feature and arrangement pattern of these proteins and phospholipids, there are three theories which are existing to discuss about the plasma membrane, or known as sandwich model, unit membrane model, and fluid mosaic model. Let's know the different theories to know specifically about the structural composition of the plasma membrane. Plasma membrane. Here we can see it has a single layer, no? But if you observe it under electron microscope, you can observe very specifically the difference between the different structures like proteins, phospholipids, etc. To confirm the structural configuration of this plasma membrane, there are several theories are existing. Then the first theory is known as sandwich model. Which was proposed by the scientist Dawson and Danieli. So, according to these two people, the plasma membrane is like a sandwich. Then we come to know specifically the structure of this sandwich model of the plasma membrane. According to these two scientists, the main components of the plasma membrane are, say, proteins and phospholipids. Proteins and phospholipids. Okay. Then, the phospholipids specifically are containing, they are a component of the lipids as well as the phosphates, having two kinds of structures. Known head and tail. Phospholipids contain two types of portions, specifically known as a head portion as well as the tail portion. As according to the model of the sandwich, these phospholipids are present in two layers, then we call phospholipid bilayer. Same structure which is pointed in this direction. Tails face each other and heads are far away from each other. Okay? Then what's the story regarding this? Heads are specifically hydrophilic, and tails having hydrophobic nature. What is hydrophobia and hydrophilic? Means loving. They love the water molecule. The latter, the head portion of the phospholipids loves the water molecules and they allows the water molecule inside. While coming to the tail portion, that rejects the repel the water molecules. Okay, that is known as the hydrophobic nature. Because of having this loving and rejecting, hydrophilic and hydrophobic nature, we'll call these phospholipids as amphiphotic, amphiphatic phospholipids. By having head and tails, head attracts the water molecules, tails rejects the water molecules, with the consideration of hydrophilic and hydrophobic nature. Then a bilayer, a phospholipid bilayer has formed. Then onto the phospholipid bilayer, there are presence of proteins present externally to the phospholipid bilayer. As these proteins are alpha globular proteins. What is the meaning of this alpha globular? As they are basically spherical in shape, that spherical shape globular proteins, these are in spherical shape. The spherical shape of the proteins confirm the name alpha globular. So as you can see here, the two layers of the phospholipid is surrounded by the two slices or two layers of the proteins. As you observe the sandwich also, no, in between the two layers of the bread there is a stuff like a fruits and vegetable stuff is present in between the two layers of the bread slice, how we call as a sandwich. No, here also the model of the plasma membrane is almost like isn't it stuff in the form of a phospholipids, two layers of phospholipids surrounded by the two unit layers of the proteins. Because of this, isn't it specific model, the two scientists Danieli and Davison have confirmed the name sandwich model. When comes to the functionality of this plasma membrane by these two scientists, okay, they have said that these phospholipids are amphiphotic, amphipathic in nature. No, then head portion loves the water molecules, attracts the water molecules as well. Simultaneously, the tail portion rejects the water. If a tail portion rejects the water molecule, what's the matter of entry of the water molecule inside the cell is a big question which arises. So these two are also were not able to explain about that part. So this theory was simply rejected, but it continued to know the structural formation. What they have said, this structure, no, 100% is correct, but only the thing they are unable to say about the transportation of water by having this hydrophobic nature. So this theory is under rejected list. Then we need to know about the another theory known as urine unit membrane model. It was proposed by the scientist Robertson. Robertson was the scientist. He proposed this unit membrane theory. Then what's the difference between the sandwich model and this unit membrane model? 100% it is almost like a sandwich model in having a phospholipid bilayer. Okay, and this man also said about that amphipathic nature, head or loving water molecules by having hydrophilic, and tail portion simply rejects the water by having the hydrophobic. Then only the slight difference that this man have highlighted is in the membrane, the name itself indicating, no, the proteins or membranous proteins. In the first model by the Dawson and Danieli, they have given alpha globular proteins which are spherical in shape. Unlike that, according to this Robertson, he used structural proteins. The proteins are of structural structure. Membranous proteins. the structure of the proteins in this unit membrane model is proteins are of either a membranous or a fibrous or a thread like. In the simple notes and a simple text we can use a word thread. If a proteins are thread like, they'll occupy the portion of the phospholipid bilayer. This is the structural conformation. It indicating that unit membrane model. Only the thing that varies in the shape of the proteins. In the former, we have seen the globular or spherical proteins. In this present case, we are learning about the membranous proteins. If a plasma membrane is composed of a membranous proteins or a thread or a fibrous proteins like this, then this kind is known as unit membrane model, which is proposed by the Robertson. And everything that he said relates to the sandwich model. And in addition to this sandwich model, they have said the length and diameter of the unit membrane. That is one extra notes concerns with this, as well almost is similar to the sandwich model. Okay, when comes to know this unit membrane model is also still existing in the rejected one. Existed as a rejected theory, as it is also unable to explain the transport of water molecule as basic of the hydrophobia. Step model is fluid mosaic model, which is proposed by the scientist Singer and Nicholson. Okay, like this, let's discuss about that fluid mosaic model. According to the fluid mosaic model by the Singer and Nicholson, this plasma membrane having same story as like in the unit membrane as well as in the sandwich. Like these contain phospholipid bilayers as the same thing. And according to this theory, we need to know about the proteins now. The thing which varies only in case of the proteins. According to these two people, the proteins are of two types, known as extrinsic and intrinsic. Proteins are of two types. Then the extrinsic proteins, they occupy the external portion. Extrinsic proteins occupy the external portion of the phospholipid bilayer, as well the intrinsic proteins occupies the internal portion of the phospholipid bilayer. But these intrinsic portions either partially or completely embedded within the lipid bilayer like this. If they'll occupy only the half portion inside the lipid layer, then we'll call partially embedded. If they'll occupy the full length of the lipid bilayer, then we'll call those as completely embedded protein, intrinsic a protein. So, by having the two kinds, extrinsic and intrinsic proteins, the structure of the plasma membrane completed. Then, these two scientists have specifically given explanation about the transport of water molecule as it is lack in the previous two theories. So, according to these two people, no? Here, we are available with the intrinsic proteins. They may either partially or completely embedded. No? So, with the help of these proteins, intrinsic proteins, either a fat soluble or a protein soluble or a water soluble component may easily pass from outside to the inside. So, because of this explanation, this theory was fallen into so successful, and this theory as famous theory by explaining the entry or transport or other soluble materials from outside to the inside, especially the transport of the water which is taking place by the completely embedded proteins from outside to inside portion of the cell. So this theory was so successful theory in explaining about the structure of the plasma membrane. Here these proteins look like, so we have a famous quote concerns with this theory, you know, protein icebergs in the sea of lipids. They have mentioned the structural conformation of this, no, as a protein icebergs in the sea of lipids. So the lipids are considered as a sea, in that the proteins are floated like a ice, is the famous quote regards with the Singer and Nicholson model of the fluid mosaic model, which explains about the plasma membrane. Let's know about the functions of the plasma membrane. When come to the function, as I already told that it is involved in the passage from outside to the inside and inside to the outside. So in that way, by allowing materials or insoluble or a soluble particles from inlet to outlet, it acts as a semi permeable membrane or selectively permeable membrane. So its function is semi permeability, as it is allowing soluble portions from inside to outside of the cell and outside to inside of the cell. We'll move into cytoplasm, the main important portion which is present inside the plasma membrane is known as the cyte. So here cell wall is a rigid portion and this plasma membrane is a membranous structure. Cell wall confirms the rigidity, plasma membrane involved in permeability as well. What about the cytoplasm? When comes to the structural composition of the cytoplasm, it's a fluid or an amorphous structure composed of several cell organelles known as the cytoplasm. The structure or a substance which is present in the cytoplasm is so transparent, amorphous in nature, and also it able to hold some of the cell organelles inside to it. That's the, isn't it, credibility of the cytoplasm. You can see here very clearly that the fluidic material specifically known as the cytoplasm. Then what is the speciality of the cytoplasm? It is a fluid material, that fluid having amorphous nature, so along with the fluid it contains a cytoplasmic matrix, contains substances. The substances or the cytoplasmic matrix is the site for cell organelles. Several cell organelles which are embedded, which are attached to the cytoplasmic matrix, as it is, the matrix is acts like a site or like a seat to attach or the present or to present a cell organelles. This cytoplasmic matrix is very important, which is present. This cytoplasmic matrix is a substance used to hold organelles. Okay, then the fluid contains several enzymes which are responsible for metabolism or metabolic activities like glycolysis, etc. Altogether, this cytoplasm is a fluid material contains several metabolic enzymes meant for the glycolysis, as well it contains a matrix portion which acts as a seat for various cell organelles like chloroplast. Chloroplast is not in red color, but I'm drawing here because I'm not aware with the green pen, sorry for that. Okay, this chloroplast, you can consider these as thylakoid units and lamella as well. This contains mitochondria with the folded structures, as it is contains ribosomes are not present directly. Endoplasmic reticule, which is the site of ribosome, as well lysosomes and several and a large vacuole, etc. structures are present. Cell organelles are present within the cytoplasm. So, the cytoplasm is a liquid or a fluid portion consists of several cell organelles. Cell organelles are present within the matrix portion, and the portion which contains only enzyme or fluid is known as cytosol. Cytoplasm excluding cell organelles known as the cytosol, which consists of enzymes meant for glycolysis. And cytoplasmic matrix is a site for the cell organelles. Let's know about the cell organelles which are present inside the cell wall, like chloroplast and mitochondria and some other cell organelles which are present in the cytoplasm. So as it is a plant cell, we need to discuss and we need to give more priority and importance to the chloroplast, because it's a very specific cell present only to the plant, meant for photosynthesis, no? Chloroplast is a very specialized cell organelle present in the plant cells. So the greenness to the plant is only because of the presence of chloroplast. Then what is chloroplast? A chloroplast is a oval structure. It's almost oval in shape, and it consists of two membranes which are united together. Membrane, a structure composed of two membranes. Outer one is known as outer membrane and inner one is known as inner membrane. And in between the two membranes, we can observe a space we'll call periplastidial space. Then when come to inside to the chloroplast, it is divided into two compartments. One is a dark filled portion, consists of several enzymes known as stroma. This stroma involved in the dark reactions of photosynthesis for the carbohydrate fixation by the process of photosynthesis, as well then inside to the stroma and within the stroma one more structure we'll call grana. Grana is a structure with meant for light reactions of the photosynthesis. Then now what is grana? Grana is nothing, it is like a stack. A stack like structure which is present inside the chloroplast, okay, known as thylakoid. This thylakoid is involved in the light reactions of the photosynthesis. Then it is a unit structure composed of several particles, no? Then each particle is known as grana. By composing of many grana, it is united like a thylakoid. Then the thylakoid as well grana involved in the This grana or thylakoid is meant for light reactions of the photosynthesis by involving photolysis of water. Then the two thylakoid units are interconnected like this. We'll call that interconnected portion to the stroma and to the grana or thylakoid known as stroma lamella. Stroma lamella is a ladder like a structure or a bridge like structure which connects two thylakoid units and to the stroma. Altogether, it is the structure of the chloroplast involved in the process of photosynthesis by enzymes present in the stroma, as well involved in the light reactions, especially in photolysis of water with the help of thylakoid units or grana. You can also observe a space which is present inside the grana known as lumen. Altogether, with all these parts, the chloroplast, specifically a plant cell organelle involved in the process of photosynthesis. As it is bounded by a membrane, then it is unit membrane structure and membranous cell organelle. We also discuss about another cell organelle known as mitochondria. As like chloroplast, this mitochondria is also a membrane bound cell organelle composed of two membranes. It is a rod. This mitochondria is a rod shaped structure composed of two membranes. Outer membrane is rough because it specifically studded with ribosomes. Then the inner membrane is like a folded structures. We call cristae. Mitochondria is also consists of two membranes, outer membrane and inner membrane. Outer membrane look to be rough because of the presence of ribosomes, as well that outer membrane is also consists of a porous, then we'll call this mitochondrial membrane as a porous membrane. When come to the inside portion of the mitochondria, it is the inside portion is folded into several helices. We'll call that as cristae. As well, this cristae is involved in specific enzymes meant for electron transport. So because of involving in several physiological mechanisms, it gained ATP, and those ATP is stored within the mitochondria. For that purpose, this mitochondria is known as powerhouse of the cell or cell currency. Mitochondria is known as powerhouse, power house of the cell or cell currency because of production of number of ATP by participating in several mechanical reactions, physiological reactions like a Krebs cycle, electron transport, oxidative phosphorylation, etc. Reactions which occur inside the mitochondria. With the result of all those mechanisms, there is release of an energy in the form of ATP and NAD and NADH, etc. As altogether, it involved in storage of energy, certain energy sources. The mitochondria is famous as powerhouse of the cell as well cell currency. And I already discussed about the chloroplast and the mitochondria. Now, there are number of similarities between these two organelles. Those are both the chloroplast and mitochondria are composed of two membranes as well involved in the metabolic activities, as well both the chloroplast and mitochondria contains DNA, and the DNA which is present in this chloroplast and mitochondria are spherical in shape, and this DNA has the capacity of undergoing self replication. Because of participation in self replication, the DNA present in the mitochondria and chloroplast, the two cell organelles, mitochondria and chloroplast, are famous as semi-conservative cell organelles. Semi-conservative nature is applicable with the circular DNA as it is involved in the self replication in producing daughter copies. So, chloroplast and mitochondria are semi-conservative cell organelles or semi-autonomous cell organelles. Chloroplast and mitochondria, some other important cell organelles, so endoplasmic reticulum, which is a dividend of tubules, vesicles and helicase structures. Altogether, it is known as ear. If it is concerns with the ribosomes, then we'll call rough ear. Then if a smooth is present, a smooth ear, rough endoplasmic reticulum and smooth endoplasmic reticulum. That roughness is confers by the presence of ribosomes, and ER is involved in the production of the ribosomes. Okay, then the ribosomes are another important cell organelles which are present in the cytoplasm. So how like ER involved in the production of the ribosomes, then these ribosomes are involved in the production of RNA and different types of RNA like mRNA, snRNA, etc. RNAs are produced from the ribosomes. And in addition to this, there are organelles, no? We discussed briefly about that before going there. Know about the nucleus, and we need to know about the vacuole also. Vacuole is a large structure which doesn't have a specific shape, as it is mainly filled with the water, and by having a plenty of water in it, it confers humidity inside the cell and also actively participate in the reactions of osmosis, diffusion, etc. So as it is contains no the most percentage of water in the cytoplasm confers to the vacuole. If it loses, the vacuole loses the water, it may decrease in the size as well, come to a periphery. And similarly, if obtain a more amount of water, it increases the size, and in this condition also it pushes the nucleus to the periphery. So because of the presence of a vacuole in the cytoplasm, the position of the nucleus is most probably to the periphery of the cytoplasm. Okay, with this I have completed about the most important cell organelles which are present in the cytoplasm, and next we'll go about nucleus. Important part in the plant cell is nucleus. Nucleus is considered as a vital portion because nucleus confers the life, nucleus confers the vitality, nucleus confers the fertility by having the concerned genes, by enclosing the concerned genes on it. Okay, so nucleus is considered as the most important and a vital portion within the cell. Then where it locates, a nucleus is located inside the nuclear membrane. Nucleus is rigidly bounded by a membranous structure known as nuclear membrane. Okay, then inside the nuclear membrane, how like plasma membrane, no? This nuclear membrane is also a membrane structure, and it is also composed of two layers. Then come to know the structure of this nuclear membrane specifically. It is composed of two layers like this. So this is the structure of the nuclear membrane. It is simply composed of the two layers, outer and the inner. The outer layer is considered as exo layer or exine. The inner layer is considered as intine or internal layer. Then there is a space now in between the two membranes or two layers. We call that as that space as perinuclear space. Perinuclear. As you can also observe a bit of space in between the membranous portion, we'll call that space as nuclear pore. Nuclear pores. This nuclear pores probably meant for facilitation or the movement of particles from inside to outside the cytoplasm. Inside of the nucleus to cytoplasm and cytoplasm to the inside of the nucleus. There are, isn't it, more number of pores which are uniquely present in between the or by interrupting the nuclear membrane. As you come to know that nuclear membrane is a membranous structure composed with the two layers. Outer is known as exine and inner is known as intine. There is a space in between two membranes known as perinuclear space. Inside to the nuclear membrane, there is a liquid or a fluid filled space present known as nucleoplasm. Nucleoplasm contains several enzymes which are involved in DNA replication. Then inside the nucleoplasm, there is a dense body known as nucleoli. A liquid or fluid-like structure inside the nuclear membrane is known as nucleoplasm. It contains several enzymes like DNA polymerase, etc., involved in the DNA replication as well. Then this nucleoplasm contains a dense figure or a dense portion, a spherical body known as a nucleoli. This nucleoli are probably involved in the formation of structures like a centromere and kinetochore, while at the mitosis and meiosis, and as well while the formation of the chromosomes by the chromatin material. Okay, then come to know the structures of the nucleus. Nucleus consists of a membrane bound structure known as nuclear membrane. Nuclear membrane, and the nuclear membrane is interrupted by pores known as nuclear pores, meant for facilitation. And inside the nuclear membrane, a liquid or fluid filled region known as nucleoplasm, concerned with the enzymes involved in DNA replication. As well, the nucleoplasm also contains a dense body known as nucleoli, involved in the formation of centromere or kinetochore, etc. structure to hold two arms of the chromosome as well of the spindle fibers, which are formed at the mitosis and meiosis. Then the main portion concerns with the nucleus is the presence of a chromatin material. Chromatin material is usually a long thread or fibrous material composed of histone proteins. Then this chromatin material is involved in the formation of chromosomes. Involved in the formation of chromosomes. Okay? And these chromosomes are the sites of genetic material of DNA and RNA. and the two arms of the chromosomes are connected by a centromere, which is a portion formed from the nucleoli. As well, this centromere is also surrounded with tubular structures known as kinetochores. These kinetochores are also probably formed from the nucleoli. Then altogether, these I'll draw here also no structure of the nucleus and the chromatin material. Then it is the chromatin material involved in the formation of chromosomes, as well the chromosomes meant for the consists of genetic material DNA and RNA. So this is about an ultrastructure of the plant cell by covering the parts like a cell wall, which is an external portion, and inside to the cell wall there is membrane structure known as plasma membrane. Cell wall confirms the rigidity, plasma membrane meant for permeability. It allows molecules from inside to inflow and outflow. As well, inside to the plasma membrane there is a liquid or a fluid like structure known as cytoplasm. That cytoplasm contains several enzymes along with the cell organelles. That cell organelles like a chloroplast and mitochondria, as we already discussed. Chloroplast involved in photosynthesis, mitochondria involved in respiration. Chloroplast for photosynthesis, mitochondria acts as a powerhouse by performing several physiological mechanisms. Endoplasmic reticulum for the synthesis of ribosomes, and ribosomes meant for the synthesis of RNA. And vacuole is filled with the water, and because of that, isn't it, evaporation and absorption process that involved in the process or mechanisms like osmosis and diffusion, etc. And while go in depth into the cell, there is a membranous, one more membranous structure known as nuclear membrane, which is present just inside to the cytoplasm, and it protects the nucleus. Then inside the portion of the nucleus there is a fluid filled region known as nucleoplasm, contains several enzymes meant for DNA replication, and it also contains a dense body known as nucleoli involved in the formation of centromere and kinetochore. Then it also contains a hugely a thread like or a fibrous or a membranous material known as chromatin material, which is composed of histone proteins. And this is, if we go into discuss about the chromatin, it is a very huge chapter. We need to discuss with more time. Then okay, I'm just giving what is what about. Now it is composed of the histone proteins, as well those involved in the formation of the chromosomes, and chromosomes altogether the enclosing the genetic material in the form of DNA and RNA. And the DNA and RNA which is present onto the chromosomes confers hereditary and inheritance. And with this I am completed about ultrastructure of the plant cell. Thank you for giving this so extraordinary and valuable opportunity.